profesor en el Departamento de Matemática en UMass en Amherst, en los Estados Unidos, y está por un año de sabático en la Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile, en Santiago, y ha tenido la beca Sloan, Simons Fellow, and ese Fulbright Fellow, que es, creo que lo trajo, lo ayudó a venir a Chile. Tiene trabajos muy interesantes en matemática y también tiene otros intereses, como por ejemplo la geometría de los textiles precolombinos. Pueden encontrar algo en su página web y otras que desconozco. Así que bueno, es un gran honor tenerlo con nosotros y va a hablar de un título que le decía a Jenia, que entiende bastante castellano, que era para mí imposible de traducir, así que lo voy a pronunciar en mi mal inglés. Y es The Forest Behind the Hyper Trees, Scattering Amplitudes from Stable Curves. Jenia.
Okay, well, thank you so much for
Just one second, I forgot. Please ask your question using the chat, and then at some moment I will ask the questions, pass the questions to Jenia. So you please use the chat, which is in the bottom part of the Zoom, to ask your questions. Sorry.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Alicia, for the invitation and introduction. You know, so I'm going to talk about a relatively new project, but it's sort of connected to some of my previous work, and you know, hopefully, you know, you'll like it. You know, so let me start, you know, with quantities that up to zero. So it's well known that there are sort of two sources for quantities like this. You know, so in physics, well, if you have n outgoing particles, and if you have some incoming particles, you can always switch it to an antiparticle and it will become outgoing. You know, you have a conservation law for momenta, right? That the sum of the momenta is zero. On the other hand, in mathematics, well, there is, I would argue, one canonical place where you encounter quantities that add up to zero, and those are residues, right? So if you have a meromorphic form on a compact Riemann surface, C, you know, for simplicity, let's say it has simple poles at n marked points, then you have a residue theorem, right? Poincaré residue theorem, that the sum of the residues adds up to zero. Sort of a well-known fact and sort of an inspiration for a lot of beautiful research in mathematics is that this is sort of a canonical place to encounter quantities that add up to zero. You know, so there is this kind of a very basic exact sequence that if you evaluate residues of a form and then add them up, well, so then the kernel is, well, so it's going to be a surjective map. And the kernel consists of all holomorphic forms, so forms without these simple poles at n marked points. Right, and so, well, so if you want to study, for example, momentum of particles, then you know what we can study instead are vectors of forms, we can look at their residues. Sort of a lot of my research is not about smooth Riemann surfaces, even though for the most of this talk I'll just stick to smooth Riemann surfaces, okay? I prefer to think about them as smooth algebraic curves over complex numbers. But this also works, you know, for stable algebraic curves, which is basically, you know, when you take a Riemann surface and, you know, you punch a vanishing cycle to a point, you know, so you can take a Riemann sphere and, you know, attach two points together. This is an example of a stable algebraic curve, sort of like a nodal cubic surface. So this calculation with residues works just as fine. So in other words, for example, a smooth Riemann surface and then points, well, we can model whatever problem we want on this residue. So,
Jenny, could you define the Riemann surface?
Well, just a compact Riemann surface. Yeah, like a Riemann surface of a function, you know, let's say, yeah. You know, for example, like in my talk, most of them will be very simple. For example, a Riemann sphere, so C completed by a point at infinity, or an elliptic curve, you know, a quotient of C by a lattice, Z plus Z, so things like that. So something is like a complex manifold of dimension one, you know, something that locally looks like an open disk in C. Right, and so now, so basically what are we trying to do, right? So on the mathematical side, you know, we can imagine a random process of some sort, you know, that produces a vector of this
log forms, these meromorphic forms. And of course, you know, this is all purely mathematical objects. They don't exist in reality. And so to cross into physics, well, we, how do we cross? We need to measure something, right? And that's exactly what we do here, right? So if we take residues of these log forms, you know, then we get a vector of numbers, just a finite dimensional vector of numbers. And when we have such a thing, well, I mean, we are in business, right? We can, for example, get a sample of them, and then we will get a probability distribution of these numbers, right? And then what we can ask, well, what is the probability distribution of these residues? How does it look like? You know, what does it tell us about the curve? So that's what I'm going to talk about. So to be a little bit more concrete, you know, so what is a meromorphic form, right? So a meromorphic form, it's locally looks like, you know, a meromorphic function f of z, well, multiplied by dz, right? So it sort of looks like a function, but it's not really a function, right? You know, because when you change charts on your Riemann surface, pass from one open subset to another, functions you just identify, right? But forms you have to multiply by the Jacobian of your coordinate transformation, right? So you know, in the language we use in geometry, you know, a form is not a function, but it's a section of a complex line bundle. It transforms differently a little bit when you go from one chart to the next chart. But the thing is that on the Riemann surface, of course, you know, you have a lot of line bundles, right? And so my random process that I'm going to study in this talk is very simple. It will be just a random factorization. You know, so I will take my line bundle, you know, the line bundle of all possible meromorphic forms, you know, with simple poles at n points. With simple poles at n points, and I will factor it into a tensor product of two line bundles, L and L tilde. That's my random process. You know, and so L will be a line bundle of degree d, L tilde will be a line bundle of degree d tilde, and the sum of the degrees must be the same as the degree of this line bundle of all meromorphic forms, you know, with simple poles, which is just a standard calculation, 2g minus 2 plus n, where G is the genus. G is the genus, is the number of holes in the Riemann surface. So why does this make sense? Well, it makes sense because we can look at all possible line bundles of degree D, and the standard fact, you know, from the theory of Riemann surfaces, this is a complex torus, right? It's a quotient of a finite dimensional complex vector space, C to the G, by the lattice, Z to the 2G. So it's just a, you know, look, it looks like a torus sort of real dimension 2G, but it's also a complex variety, a manifold of a complex dimension G. What it has, I mean, it has this kind of a translation invariant volume form, right? Because after all, it comes from CG, from a vector space. And there you can just take a wedge of coordinates, dz1, dz2, dzn, it's like a standard volume form. Right, and of course, in the vector spaces, you know, you get infinite volume, but here we quotient by the lattice to get a compact torus, so you'll get a finite volume, right? And so it makes perfect sense, you know, to talk about uniform probability. It gives you a measure, like a uniform probability measure, translation invariant measure. And so picking a random line bundle is a fantastic thing to do, right? Because you it has this kind of a uniform probability distribution. So I have to say here in quotes that if the curve is stable, if it has some points which are pinched, you know, then the Picard group is not honestly like this. It's not necessarily a compact torus. So it will have a not compact factors, and they do complicate here a little bit, but I'm not going to dwell on this detail at all in my talk. So just imagine that the Picard group is compact, and that's fine, just a compact torus. Okay, so this was the first step of the random process, but unfortunately it's not enough, right? Because you know what I want a concrete meromorphic form. And so it's not enough to just to get the line bundle of all possible meromorphic forms. I have to, you know, choose a specific one. Well, I mean, you know, I have this tensor product decomposition, you know, so a section of one line bundle, whatever that means, locally looks like a meromorphic function on a Riemann surface, but you know, transforms differently, and you know, and I can take a global section of another line bundle, And since I want to do sort of dynamics in some finite dimensional, but not one dimensional space, I need to choose not just one section, but a vector of sections, right? You know, so I choose a vector of sections S alpha, and I choose a vector of sections S alpha Tweedle of a different line bundle. I tensor these sections together, I get a matrix, right? So I get a matrix of forms. Locally, they look like this FZ, DZ, but they depend on indices alpha and alpha Tweedle. And so what I would like to do, I would like to study probability distribution of this matrix. You know, if I sample 1,000 sections, you know, how we, you know, what kind of a fitting curve I'm going to get, you know, for the statistics of these numbers. And that's great, but there is a problem in this approach. And the problem, and you already see it if you have any kind of a knowledge of probability theory, that of course there is no canonical probability distribution on this vector space, right? So the space of all sections by beautiful theorem of Serre is a finite dimensional vector space, but we're not quotienting by a lattice or anything. So it does have a volume form, but it has infinite volume, right? So it's not a probability distribution. And that's a problem. It's a serious issue. And so how are we going to attack, you know, this issue? And so here it's sort of interesting for me because, as Alicia mentioned, you know, I spent the first 20 years of my life as a mathematician in Russia. And in Russia, you know, there is a canonical solution to this problem, right? If you have some choices to make, never make them. You know, consider all choices together. You know, maybe that's why I study moduli problems, because I don't want to lose any information. And so in this case, this would amount to considering all possible probability distributions. You know, so for example, you know, how can one get such a distribution? Well, maybe one can take a Hermitian form. So one can choose a Hermitian a metric on a line bundle, and this will give you a Hermitian metric on this space of global section by integrating it over Riemann surface. But there are infinitely many, it's an infinite dimensional problem, right? And it's sort of like an analysis problem, not an algebraic geometry problem, because I like to have this finite dimensionality equations that depend on finitely many variables, right? And it's sort of way above my pay grade, I mean, this kind of approach. The second part of my life I spent in America, right? And in America, we have a very nice solution to this problem of confronting the unknowns, right? So, and the solution to confronting the unknowns is to ignore them. sometimes this gives very big problems, ignoring the unknown, but sometimes it works beautifully. So in physics, well, they ignore unknowns routinely. They would put some delta function somewhere and say that it makes sense, but we can't do this. We are mathematicians. So how do we ignore the unknowns, right? So there is amazing kind of a quote from Rumsfeld, you know, who used to be like a Defense Department during the Bush administration, which sort of gives you a recipe, right? Which unknowns you should ignore and which unknowns you shouldn't ignore, right? So L, the line bundle, is kind of like a known unknown, because fine, it's a random variable, but we know its probability distribution. So we shouldn't ignore it. We have control over it. But then these sections, of this vector is in a finite dimensional vector space, this sort of unknown unknowns. We don't know any, we don't know what's the probability distribution, and we don't want to focus much on what these unknown unknowns are, right? And so the solution to this is to say, well, okay, maybe I'm asking too much, you know, because I want to understand this distribution of all the residues, but this involves this unknown unknowns, which I don't have any control of. And so in solution to this problem, it's a very general kind of idea from probability theory and statistics, is to design a random variable better. So instead of trying to understand all possible residues that you get from your matrices, and so here I have this space Y, which parameterizes all possible residues. Instead, I'll design a random variable. I'll take a function of this residues. I'll call it lambda from Y to M. I mean, M will be some space. It will come up in a second. And then if this map lambda does not depend on these unknown unknowns on these sections, then it essentially only depends on a line bundle, right? So then it will descend, to a map. From this Picard group of line bundles into M, and that's great, because then describing a probability distribution on M becomes a well-posed problem. So that's sort of, that's like how we are going to do it, and that's how secretly a lot of physicists think about this problem, similar problems, but we are going to pursue it religiously, right, this approach. And I have to say, for those of you who are not algebraic geometers, I will be using this dashed notation a lot for maps. So in algebraic geometry, like typically maps that we consider are polynomial maps. I mean, they're given by polynomials in some variables, so they're everywhere defined. But it's well known that it's easier to study rational maps. I mean, maps given by rational functions, like ratios of polynomials. And so such a function is not going to be everywhere defined. It's not going to be defined where your denominator is zero. But in algebraic geometry, this set has like a zero measure, right? It has a smaller dimensional locus, right? So this map is still defined on a dense open subset, and it's often good enough. You know, for some problems, we can try to do better. We can design a resolution of the map, or some compactifications of open sets, and make the map actually everywhere well defined. But at the first approximation, it's just good enough to have this partially defined maps define an open subset. So that's what we are going to do. So what are we going to do here, right? So we're going to use the idea from physics. So I will focus on the 2x2 case. Right, so I want to understand a 2x2 matrix of forms. So this is the space of 2x2 matrices, right? But then you see the form that I get is not an arbitrary matrix, you know, because I write it as a tensor product of a row vector and a column vector, you know, and so as a result, you know, you get matrices of rank at most one, of course, right? So you get the subset L in the set of all 2x2 matrices. And what is this subset? Well, it's just a subset of matrices of determinant zero. It's a quadric hypersurface, like given by equation of degree two, right? And in algebraic geometry, we like to projectivize things. So instead of thinking about a locus in C4, we projectivize, we get a locus in P3, and it's just isomorphic to the product of P1 and P1, two projective lines taken together. So how this show up in physics? Well, I mean, in physics, this space of matrices, 2x2 matrices, if you put a correct real form on it, given by Pauli matrices, you know, this will be a Minkowski space, with signature 1-3, and L will be a complex complexified light cone, right? What we are looking at, n massless particles, right, in four dimensions. One is the time and then the three spatial dimensions. Our residues, right, so residues of our matrix, well, it's a point of this algebraic variety, right? You take n points in L, so n matrices of determinant zero, you know, with this nice condition that's given to you for free by the residue theorem, that the sum of momenta is PIs is equal to zero. Okay, so that's the problem, like the physical problem. And so now what are the random variables we are going to use? Well, those are beautiful sort of variables known as spinner variables in physics. So basically what this thing is, right? So we have our variety Y shown above, all this points in L that end up to zero. This maps, you can just project it onto P1, right? You know, because this projectivized L is just P1 times P1. So I can just project onto the first factor, or I can project into the second factor. So I have actually two maps, you know, one given by projecting L to the first factor, and another given by projecting this L to the second factor, P1. So those are known as spinner variables in physics. But we should do one step more, right? So what is the point of P1 to the N? Well, it's just N numbers, right? P1 is a number or infinity, right? The Riemann sphere, and so when you have N points in P1, what you can do, you can take it modulo PGL2. So this is the last line of this slide. You know, if you have N points in P1, which are distinct points. So let's take Q1, Qn are distinct points in P1. We can just take it modulo PGL2, right? And this gives the variety which I study a lot, which is called M0n, So it's just the configuration space or the moduli space, whatever you call it, of n distinct points in P1 modulo PGL2. It's a very simple space. For example, you can normalize the first three points to be 0, 1, and infinity by applying an element of PGL2, a Möbius transformation, and then the remaining points, well, they will land wherever they land, right? So it's a very simple space to describe. Yes, so and so this will be my random variables. So they go from all possible, from the space of all residues, which is a subset in the product of L, this light cone with itself and times. And then I project onto one copy of P1, and then I take it modulo PGL2. Right, so we will see this map a lot today, you know, and so you will get used to it, you know, once we go through examples and pictures. Okay, so that's cool. And so now I have to sort of give you a definition of what kind of what is my setup I'm going to consider. And this definition basically comes from physical considerations, right? So what kind of curves should I consider? So MHV, so this is the terminology from physics, is called maximum helicity violating, and I'm not going to get into why it's called like that. It's a sort of a separate talk. so a curve like this will be, well, it's a stable curve. Well, you can just think a smooth Riemann surface, that's good enough, a smooth curve. So it will have genus G, it will have N marked points, and also I have to fix a degree. So ignore that this degree has a vector on top of it. I'll get back to this later. So just degree of a line bundle, right? And so I take all of them. So I take this whole connected component of the Picard group, right? So this connected component, as we've seen, is a complex torus of dimension G, right? So I need all this data. So I need a curve, you know, I need n points on the curve, and I need this complex torus parameterizing all degree D line bundles. But interestingly, these numbers will satisfy conditions, and these conditions come from physics. And I'm not going to explain the relation to physics, but there are two conditions of sort of a slightly different nature. One is that I don't want any constraints on momenta, and this forces n, the number of marked points, to be g plus 3 always. You know, throughout my talk, n will be g plus 3. And then d, the degree, again, from the physical considerations on ignoring unknown unknowns, has to be g plus 1. So that's all, that's it, g plus 1. So there are other regimes, not MHV regimes, which one can study. Very interesting. I think I'm going to do this after I finish this project. But in the MHV case, these numbers are like this. N is always G plus 3, D is always G plus 1. And so maybe it's superficial to keep three numbers which are always related the same way. But I sort of want to do it because, you know, for me, G is a number of holes, a genus. So it's something coming from the Riemann surface. N is the number of points. Well, it's M0N, so M0N, very important. And then D is sort of, comes from this Picard group, right? So it's this complex torus that parameterizes line bundles. Okay, and then I have to impose some conditions which maybe looks a bit technical for you, but you know, we'll get past that very soon. So the condition, so there are several conditions. So first of all, you know, if I take a generic line bundle with this degree, it's a completely random point on this torus, it should have exactly two global sections. One is say X and then one is Y. So in the language of algebraic geometry, this is called a not special divisor, right? So this is an expected dimension. That's what you expect from Riemann-Roch theorem, which tells you how to compute these dimensions. So in this case, when D is equal to G plus one, that's what Riemann-Roch gives. If you know what Riemann-Roch is and you compute, you will see that it gives you two, right? So this space has to be two dimensional. So that's condition number one. So condition number two is that if you take this generic line bundle, so you have these two sections, Y and X. So X and Y are not functions on the Riemann surface. They're sections of the line bundle. But if you take their ratio, y over x, well, that's actually a perfectly legitimate meromorphic function on your Riemann surface. And so this gives you a meromorphic function, right? So a meromorphic function from C to P1 given by this ratio, okay? And you can say, well, if you know Riemann surfaces, you can say, well, wait a second, this is automatic. I mean, y over x is a meromorphic function, so you always have that. So the only reason I'm writing this down like this is because for stable curves, for curves with punctures, you know, for curves with this shrunk cycle, this is not automatic. But for smooth Riemann surfaces, this condition is actually vacuous. This is automatic. And then what is the map I'm going to study? My scattering amplitude map, the main sort of a subject of this talk. Well, it's the map from the complex torus of actually dimension G. And remember, G is n minus 3. So it's a G dimensional torus to M0n, well, which is also have dimension, the same dimension, because dimension of M0n is n minus 3. You can normalize 3 points, then the rest are 3. So it has dimension n minus 3. So this is a map from between two spaces of the same dimension. And what this map does, it takes a line bundle. From this line bundle, it produces a meromorphic function. So you take a random line bundle, and then you get your random meromorphic function, phi L. And then you evaluate your meromorphic function at your n fixed points. Well, this gives you n points in P1. Well, and you just take them in M0n. Instead of thinking about n points in P1, you can think about 1 point in M0n, right? So that's the map. That's the scattering amplitude map. And the condition is that, so it's the map between two spaces of the same dimension. So I want it to have dense image, or equivalently, I want it to have generically finite fibers, right? So that's the slide. And so we're going to digest this as we go along, because I will show you a lot of examples, and you'll get used to this data. And just to make things easier immediately, well, so the first theorem is that in fact, every smooth Riemann surface is an MHV curve. So you don't need to worry about any of these conditions. This is always the case. You can always compute these statistics and get a probability distribution, hopefully. And by the way, what is this probability distribution? Well, as we discussed on the complex torus, you have your uniform distribution, and you just view, you know, this this volume form on the torus as a form on downstairs on M0n. And because the map has finite fibers, it's not going to be a one-to-one form, it's going to be a multi-valued form, but it will be a multi-valued meromorphic form on M0n, right? And that's what you want to study, right? So at least over complex numbers, you know, where we don't worry that it's an actual probability distribution and the integral is one and all that. Instead, you just take this n form where n is the dimension, or actually n minus three will be the dimension. G will be the dimension of everything, and you take this form. So that's great. So let's summarize our MHV experiment, like a physics-inspired geometry. So what is this MHV experiment? So again, we have a fixed surface and we have fixed endpoints on the Riemann surface. That's our data. This is fixed. And so we're going to choose a random uniformly distributed line bundle, right? So this is the choice. And this random uniformly distributed line bundle will give us a random meromorphic function on our Riemann surface. And we are going to evaluate this meromorphic function on our marked points. And so this will give us a point on M0n. And if we do it many times, well, you know, we'll get statistics, right? So we'll get a lot of samples and we will try to understand the probability distribution on M0n, right? So that's the summary of what we want to do. So let's see what we do. So let's just go genus by genus maybe first. That's what I tried, right? So in genus zero, what is a genus zero Riemann surface? It's just a Riemann sphere, right? And so n is 3 and d is 1. So we have a Riemann sphere and we have 3 marked points on the Riemann sphere, P1, P2, P3. So in this case, there are no line bundles. In every degree, you just have one line bundle. Genus is zero, you have one line bundle. So we won't pick one. So there's just one line bundle, which in algebraic geometry, we denote as O of P1 of one. You know, so it has 2 sections as we want, which are just homogeneous coordinates on P1, X and Y, right? So those are the homogeneous coordinates on P1. The ratio, so X and Y themselves are not functions on P1 because, you know, you can rescale X and Y, but the ratio is, you know, Y over X. I should have written this down. This phi L is just, you know, standard coordinate on P1. So this phi L is an isomorphism, right, of P1 with itself. Okay, very nice. So this isomorphism takes 3 points, P1, P2, P3 into 3 distinct points. But remember that we want to normalize things. You know, we take not points, but points modulo PGL2. And it's a standard exercise, right? The complex analysis, you can always move 3 points to 0, 1, and infinity by Möbius transformation, by fractional linear transformation, by an element of PGL2. There are all sorts of words for this group. So we don't, there are no choices here, right? Any 3 points are the same. Any 3 points in P1 is just 0, 1, infinity after you normalize. So the scattering amplitude is as simple as it gets, right? It's just a map from a point, a Picard group into a point, which is M03. That's it, end of story. Good, genus zero, we passed that. Genus one, elliptic curves. So in genus one, N is 4, D is 2. Right, so we have an elliptic curve. It's a complex torus, C modulo lattice, Z plus Z. We have 4 points on the elliptic curve. And what do? We study degree two maps. We study degree two maps from C to P1, right? Well, so in other words, you know, we are studying like random ways to present C as a double cover of P1, right? So we all know this picture, which shows C as a double cover of P1. So I think mostly people like when one of the points is moved to infinity, and so that we have a Weierstrass normal form, for a cubic curve. But you know, we don't have to do that. You know, we can take a polynomial degree 4; it's still an elliptic curve. Right, so we have this elliptic curve for y squared is equal to f of x, where f is a polynomial of degree 3 or 4. But secretly, something that maybe not everybody realizes is that this presentation is not unique. If we choose a different line bundle L, we'll get a different way to write down C as a double cover. And we take them all, right? We take all possible ways to write down C as a double cover of P1. And then what is our scattering amplitude map? So we take this line bundle L, you know, this double cover from C to P1. So we take a point L. And where do we send this point? Well, so we are supposed to apply L to 4 marked points, right? So we have these 4 points, P1, P2, P3, P4. So those are green points on the elliptic curve. We project them to P1, we take this double cover, so they go to these 4 blue dots, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, right? So those are the images by phi L. And so those are 4 points in P1. And then we don't want to take 4 points in P1, we want to take it modulo PGL2, but it's well known how to do that, right? If you have 4 points in P1, then you normalize the first 3 points to be 0, 1, infinity, and then the rest one maps somewhere, but not in at 0, 1, infinity, and it's called the cross ratio map, right? So it's actually written down here, right? So if you have four points in P1, you can write down this expression, and this will tell you where do you land in P1, right? So that's how you classify 4 points in P1. So this is our scattering amplitude map, right? So it takes a line bundle L into this procedure. So L gives us a double cover, we project points, and we compute the cross ratio, right? Great. So this map, this is the scattering amplitude map, right? From peak to C to M04. And I don't know if I already wrote this down. Yes, actually I wrote this down, but I forgot to say, let's go to the previous slides. If you don't know algebraic geometry, in fact, both peak to C is actually isomorphic to C. It's a bit of an annoying, but just a fact of life. And so both peak to C and C is the same complex torus. They are isomorphic, okay? So you have as many line bundles as points on C itself. And so now let's go back here, right? So we have a map from this one-dimensional torus to P1, essentially, and we want to know what that is. So what is it? Right? Well, you use your kind of knowledge of algebraic geometry, you compute it, and sort of amazingly, it's actually also a double cover. It's just a result of a calculation. So in the complex torus model, so lambda, the scattering amplitude map is just a Weierstrass PZ, you know, PZ function. Its inverse is the elliptic integral. Z is equal to the integral of dx over the square root of f of x, where f of x is this arbitrary sort of a random degree 3 or 4 polynomial. And so the amplitude form is just this expression, dx over the square root of f of x, where f of x is a polynomial of degree 3 or 4. And so, you know, you get this family of forms, you know, which depends on 4 complex parameters, kind of coefficients of f of x. But at this point, you should start to object, you know, because I promised a probability distribution, and I have this complex DZ form. Well, so let's go into the real world. So the reality check is to see how the whole thing looks over real numbers. You know, so we have this elliptic form, elliptic curve, right? So it has these two real ovals over real numbers. That's what we see. So over complex numbers, well, we are going to see this complex torus, but it's going to have this two ovals, right? And I do it in bold. So I have one oval which contains three marked points. So these three marked points here, and I have another oval which contains one point. So that's one point here. So that's how things look like over real numbers, at least for good curves, right? For the so-called M curves. And so, okay, well, so C has two real ovals, and then peak to C, all possible degree two covers also have two real ovals because it's the same Riemann surface as we know, right? So we can ask, what are the corresponding double covers? They should be different, right? Because you have two different ovals in peak to C, so C itself should have two different types of double covers, and that's indeed the case. So one is this given by this like kind of a Weierstrass, you know, normal form, which we saw before and which everybody knows about. So typically one of those points is moved to infinity, so you have this kind of a more familiar look for the elliptic curve. But another one is a Jacobi normal form, right? So if you take a polynomial which has two pairs of complex conjugate roots, then that's how your elliptic curve is going to look like. So it's the same curve, it's just written differently as a double cover. And it's a much better way to write it down, right? Because now we have these two components and each of them maps isomorphically, you know, to this real line. So here, we're not going to get a probability distribution, but here is a perfectly reasonable real probability distribution. But except that we don't care about C itself, right? So what we want to understand is peak to C, right? So we have this elliptic curve which parameterizes degree two line bundle on a fixed elliptic curve, or like two elliptic curves, and it's a bit confusing. And we have this 2-to-1 map into P1, which samples where these four marked points go. So it would be nice, you know, if that double cover were of this type for the real M curve, because then we would have actual probability distribution. And that's indeed the case, right? So, you know, so in genus one, so this is sort of like the main result, you know, that in fact is a very simple calculation exercise that you can give in any kind of a complex analysis course, you know, that in fact, the scattering amplitude map in genus one, you know, is gives you a real analytic isomorphism of each oval in peak to C with RP1. And if you compute the form, you will actually get a known probability distribution, it will be dx, over the square root of f4 of x, where f4 is now a polynomial without roots. So here's my favorite example of such a probability distribution. You take a square root of x squared plus a squared times x squared plus b squared, and then to normalize it, to actually have an integral equal to 1 over the whole real line, you have to multiply it by the arithmetic geometric mean of a and b and divide by pi. So it's a very nice formula. A beautiful probability distribution. I mean, so this is a bit bigger, right? So, you know, you can take any polynomial, it depends on four real parameters. Here I have two parameters, but that's okay. I mean, you know, so you will get a bit more if you take more general polynomials of degree four. You know, that's fantastic. You know, so let's move on. Let's go into higher genera. So first of all, I have to tell you again, I want to stick in this real world for a while, right? Because I like things when you can actually put in probability distribution is actually probability distribution, not some complex form. So what are these M curves in general? Well, it's a Riemann surface, kind of like what I have here. This will be a genus two Riemann surface. It has two holes. I want to have a real algebraic curve. You know, so it's basically a complex Riemann surface, but with an anti-holomorphic convolution, complex conjugation. I want it to be an M curve. M stands here for maximal, which means that I want it to have G plus one ovals, right? So I take real points, points preserved by complex conjugation. So G plus one is the maximum number you can get. So in genus two, for example, three is the maximum number you can get. So they are this in bold, these bold ovals. And this is also example of a genus two M curve. In fact, it's the same genus two M curve, just drawn differently. Because when we draw these donuts, we are kind of, you know, we do things in R3, but, you know, Riemann surface doesn't know anything about R3. So these two pictures are the same picture from the point of view of a Riemann surface. It's just, they just embedded into R3 differently. Yes, and then sort of a fun fact is that these ovals separate the Riemann surface into two parts. So here, this is like a view from above. So one is closer to us and one is sort of away from us. And on the right side, you know, one is at the top and one is at the bottom, right? So you have these two kind of caps connecting along the real locus, right? So this is a standard picture for any M curve in any genus. And then also we need to distribute points because we have this marked point. So in genus 2, we'll have 5 marked points. And I will typically stick to this scenario when you have 3 points on one component, like 1, 2, 3 on the side, and then 2 points on each of the other components. In fact, I found out there are only 2 interesting distributions of points, you know, from the point of view of scattering amplitude. The other one is on the right, you know, when you have 1 marked point on each real oval, and then you have 2 complex conjugate points. You know, so this is still a real configuration because the whole divisor of points is preserved by complex conjugation. I will stick to the left one for simplicity. That's my favorite one. As you, hopefully I'll have time to show you why this is my favorite thing. So we have such a curve, right? So this is our data. We want to understand the scattering amplitude of this real curve. But also I need to say, tell you something about the Jacobian, about this Picard group, or the torus, right? So for an M curve, a fun fact is that, you know, we take this complex torus of all complex line bundles on our Riemann surface. So this is a complex torus of complex dimension G, okay? But then if you look at real points inside this complex variety, it actually has exactly 2^g connected components. And each of these connected components is a real torus. So it's a quotient of R^g by Z^g, right? So it's basically the product of G circles, S1, 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 G times, just a real torus, as simple as it gets. So that's just a general fact about M curve. And so here is one theorem about this. So over complex numbers, what's going to happen is that the scattering amplitude, right? So the map from this complex torus of dimension G to this rational space M0n, also of dimension G, will have degree exactly 2^g. We saw it before, for example, if G is equal to 1, it's a double cover, right? So it has degree 2, which means that if you take a general point in M0n, there will be exactly 2^g line bundles on C, which give you these statistics of points. That's what it means to say that the map has a given degree. It's just a number of pre-images in a general point in M0n. But the amazing thing for me is that I always took a real, I never really liked real algebraic geometry because I thought that, okay, people prove something over complex numbers and then they digress into the real world. But here, the only way how I know how to prove this theorem, I mean, I have ideas how to prove it differently, but the only proof I have is actually by going into the real world and proving a theorem of a real algebraic geometry, which is even more amazing to me. And what this theorem says is that, okay, let's say you have a real M curve, right? So then if you take this sort of a real line bundle and apply scattering amplitude, of course you'll get N real points. So that's not very surprising, you know, that real line bundles go to real points. But what's amazing here is that the pre-image of the real locus is exactly the real, is this real locus by the scattering amplitude, right? So you have to remember a little bit that this scattering amplitude may lambda is rational map. It's not like everywhere defined, but up to that, you know, that's a true and an amazing fact. So in other words, over complex numbers, you have a map of huge degree, and we hate maps of huge degree in algebraic geometry because this has like a branch, some kind of a cover with a lot of, and it has a huge degree. But over real numbers, fibers, they kind of localize into different connected components, right? So you have this exactly 2^g connected components on the left, and for every point on M0n, you have this 2^g points, and each point goes into its own connected components. It's just really amazing to me how these things work out. Right. So, well, here I wrote down that M0n here is just over real numbers. You take n real points are in RP1 modulo PGL2 of R. That's what it means, at least in type A. Type B is different. Right. And then the restriction of the scattering amplitude map to any of this to the G connected components is a real analytic isomorphism. Right. So you have, it's kind of funny, right? So here you have this real torus that sits here. You have a real torus of real dimension G. On the right, you know, you have this sort of a real rational essentially space also of dimension G, and it's a real analytic isomorphism, at least in its domain, which is open and dense. And so if you do this, well, you will get a 4G parameter family of actually onus probability distributions, real probability distributions with integral one on this configuration space of endpoints in P1, which is amazing to me. And I have to say that there is one particularly nice component, and I'll show you in pictures how it looks like, you know, and so line bundles on, parameterized by this component were studied by a real algebraic geometer Huisman. And so I call it the Huisman's component because I used his results about these line bundles, you know, to prove the main theorem. It's a very important analysis that he did of the situation. Right, so this is the main sort of like maybe, well, the main theorem, right? So that you have this map that you want to understand. So over complex numbers, it has degree to the G, and over real numbers, it also has degree to the G, but over real numbers, it kind of localizes. You have this 2 to the G connected components in the Picard group, and the map is a real analytic isomorphism on each of these components. Really beautiful. Well, so here it is. So here's the, let's go into genus two. So let's draw some pictures. Because like for me, like you only know something in mathematics if you know how to compute it. So here I'm showing you my chops, like I can actually compute stuff. Yes, so, you know, so this is an actual probability distribution in genus two. Right? So in genus two, you know, we take degree three maps from a genus two curve to P1. You know, they have five marked points and we study their distribution of the images, and I want to stick to with the Huisman's component, which is the easiest component to draw. All right, so on the left, I have the probability distribution drawn as a function. On the right, I draw it as a density of the probability distribution. At the bottom, you know, I have a picture of a real curve, right? So it's a genus two real curve. So it's given by the equation y squared is equal to f of x, but now f of x has degree 5 or 6. And so here I decided to use it as a degree 5 curve. So that's how the real degree 2 curve looks like. And maybe I will explain this picture in the left bottom corner later. This actually sampling, right? So I'm sampling points, and I'm drawing some points, but there is a kind of technical detail here that maybe if I have time, I will explain later. So this is the actual probability distribution. So now how am I plotting them, right? So there is this kind of something I want to explain. So we take this component of the Picard group. Well, it's a real two torus, right? It's a product of two circles. It's homeomorphic to the product of two circles. So then, you know, I take the scattering amplitude map. So it's like a rational map into this configuration space of five points, five real numbers. And then, well, we already know how to study it, right? We can fix 3 points like 1, 2, 3 to be 0, 1 infinity. And then the remaining points are just numbers, right? So we get this map to R2 essentially. And that's what I'm drawing. I'm drawing a picture in R2. You can think about this as a random variable, right? So my probability distribution really lives on M0, 5, but I'm using these two coordinates on it to draw it as a probability distribution in R2. And so it's given by these two cross ratios. I have to choose these 3 points that I will normalize to 0, 1 infinity. And then the remaining 2 points will give me coordinates in R2. So there is a choice involved in this diagram. And then what is R1, right? It's a real line, but then you add infinity to it. It's a circle, right? It's a funny thing, you know, that RP1 squared is also homeomorphic to a torus, right? It's S1 for one real line and S1 to another real line. You know, so now you go through the whole diagram, you start from a two torus, and you get yourself a two torus, right? So you can ask, well, maybe it's actually a homeomorphism. And remarkably, but only for the Huisman component in genus 2, it is indeed a homeomorphism. So it's a homeomorphism from one torus, to another torus. But there are many possible choices of two cross ratios. So this is a homeomorphism, just one specific choice. It is just one specific choice of a cross ratio that that gives you this homeomorphism. So maybe I can go back to sampling. So here you see here I'm sampling points in the Picard group in the real torus, but I'm drawing them in another real two torus. And this color here represents the kind of a trajectory on the torus, right? So on the torus, I have meridians, right? I have meridians of the torus, and I'm drawing these meridians. This color is the meridian, right? But I'm drawing it on the other real torus, right? Where I'm sampling things, where I'm trying to understand probability distribution. So it's kind of remarkable that for the Huisman component, it works perfectly, but for this specific choice of cross ratios. So you can ask, well, what will happen if I choose different cross ratios? If instead of normalizing the first three points to 0, 1 infinity, I normalize some other points to 0, 1 infinity. Well, I mean, here's the answer. Things will screw up. So here I'm using, it's exactly the same scattering amplitude, exactly the same probability distribution, but written in different coordinates, right? So I'm using different cross ratios, to write it down. You see, so these trajectories of a torus meridians, they are okay up to here, but then they start loop around and the probability distribution is still fine, but it sort of shoots much higher. I mean, it's like what becomes very tall. I even had to kind of cut it here. And on the probability dense, you see this white region. So that's where the probability distribution is so high, that the free version of mathematics in the cloud I was using to draw it can't even sample it. I mean, it's just too much for it. It's still finite. It's not a delta function or anything. It's a finite probability distribution, but it just goes too high. Right. So you just have to be careful when you draw probability distribution, that sometimes you have these changes of coordinates, which are not one-to-one changes. And what looks easy, what looks easy here, right, in one in some choice of coordinates, if you choose different choice of coordinates, it will look much worse, right? So that's what it looks. That's how it. What's going on here? So if you have two different choices, if you have sort of different choices. Of these cross ratios, they are related by an operation that we call elementary transformation in algebraic geometry. You start with the grid of this R1 times R1, just standard X and Y grid. But after this coordinate transformation, sort of vertical lines, they kind of stay vertical, but some other lines, they start to pass through a point. So it's just a well-known transformation that we understand. And that's exactly what's happening here, right? So you see some of the trajectories of the torus on the right, they go fine. They just go from top to bottom. But then some of the trajectories are caught in these singularities, right? In these points that are contracted. And so they kind of go from the top. I'll try to just show you how it goes. So it goes down into the singularity and then it loops around and then it goes down. And then the close by trajectories also kind of do this kind of a looping thing. So it's okay. I mean, but what I want to emphasize is that for the Huisman component, we can avoid all this nonsense and we have a very nice homeomorphism. But for all other components, and in genus 2, there are 4 components total that we can understand. For other components, other than the Huisman component, this sort of things is unavoidable. I mean, there are some kind of a bad points, that we can. So this map, that I was giving here is not going to be a homeomorphism. There is no choice of coordinates for other components of the Picard group that make it into homeomorphism. So you will always see some kind of a looping of trajectories in other components. All right, so that's just something little thing. And so behind the curtain, I have to say, of course, for people who study dynamical systems, they might recognize some of this stuff. Because to produce these images in Mathematica, I actually don't sample points in Jacobian. There is another master space behind the curtain I want to talk about, where I sample points, which has its own probability distribution different from the translation variant volume form. But there is a standard way, how to actually get the translation variant volume form from this construction, and it's a very classical construction in dynamical systems that goes back to Jacobi, and it was sort of reimagined by Mumford and Bouville, and you know it shows up you know when you solve Kotov vector threes or Kadams of Piashvili hierarchies of differential equations. So it's kind of a well-known technology you know that I can use here to actually you know produce these nice pictures. So that's one remark how I actually did all that. And then, well, okay, I don't know how much time I have. How much time I have? When should I stop?
2 minutes.
Okay. Well, 2 minutes. okay. So, you know, maybe then I'll skip that because here is a remark, maybe more for algebraic geometers. It's really beautiful what's happening over complex numbers as well. But let me skip that. Because, you know, once you get yourself a computer program, I mean, you just can't stop playing with it.
I am stuck. Is it me?
No, you're okay.
No, so was.
Desapareció.
Se desconectó, ¿no? Se le cayó la red o algo.
Pasó lo mismo.
Bueno. Sería que se le cortó.
No se lee. No se ve, no se escucha.
Ya va a volver seguramente.
Sí, la otra vez le pasó eso y volvió. Esperemos un minuto. Muy bonitos dibujitos. Si los entendiera sería más bonito todavía. Bueno, mientras viene, para los que llegaron tarde, les contaba que en un viaje a Machu Picchu se fascinó con la geometría de los textiles precolombinos y da inclusive cursos de geometría de textiles precolombinos en Massachusetts.
Sorry, guys, I think I something I dropped the connection.
Welcome back.
Okay, so yeah, so let me just take a couple minutes to finish. So I think I prepared much more than I can possibly explain. So I will just say a little bit about what's happening as you degenerate the curve, because my original motivation for all this, and actually interestingly, physicists, they don't study smooth curves; they always study sort of degenerate curves. So we sort of had the same original interest in all this. So I'm trying to degenerate the curve, right? So I'm trying to see what's happening to the scattering amplitude as I pinch the curve, as I create these singular points in it. So something is happening, right? And then you know when you make it super degenerate, well, it sort of it becomes very boring. And then you look at it and well, it's kind of too boring, right, to be of any interest. But then you realize that, you know, that the reason why you don't see much is again has to do with the coordinate change, right? Because we chose you know, these two parameters because they work well for the Huisman component. But you see, as we degenerate the curve, it becomes something else, right? It becomes something else. It becomes this degenerate curve. You know, so we have to choose a channel, like system of coordinates, you know, that's better suitable for the object that we are hoping to, that we're kind of achieving in the limit.
And so as you change coordinates, the picture becomes much more interesting. So it becomes kind of a, like a linear, right? So, so this is actually zero. And then, so you have like a negative quadrant, and then you have a, almost like a positive.
So we are not seeing your screen. Are we supposed to see your screen?
Yes, I think so.
We are not.
Let's see. Sorry about this. Just a glitch. How about now?
No, it's okay.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so basically what I was saying is that in the boring, like in the previous one, in the coordinate system well suited for the Huisman component, the distribution looks boring. But if we change cross ratios, and we should change cross ratios because we are changing the smooth curve into something very degenerate, we see something much more interesting, right? So we see this kind of a regime, right, where the distribution becomes concentrated along rays, right? So there are these rays, this is zero, and this is zero, and this is one, and this is one. And there are these two kind of a strange rays because they correspond to some numbers, which are not obvious numbers. So there's some negative number on one side and some negative number on the other side. Which you can also see here that sort of the amplitude just avoids two regions. It's avoid two quadrants. There are no points that go here, and all points try to basically line up along these lines. There is some kind of a glitch of Mathematica. This is sort of a noise that you should ignore. And so basically, let me just show you the end, sort of like what do you get at the end. So at the end, you know, you start with a smooth Riemann 2 surface, but then you degenerate it, right? So you do this kind of a procedure, and in the limit, you know, you get a Riemann surface, you know, which is basically built from like five Riemann spheres. One Riemann sphere, another Riemann sphere, and then you know you have three more Riemann spheres in between, and then the real locus also becomes a union of two lines. So that's what I'm kind of trying to draw on the right. So here I'm just drawing real points because that's all I care about. So basically, you have two real lines in which intersect at three points, and then you have two other points, four and five, which are free points. And then remember what the scattering amplitude does. I mean, it takes a line bundle and then it uses this line bundle to map a curve to P1, and it just records statistics of points that you get at the end. And so you're sending this curve, which is a union of two P1s, into P1. So two real lines into one real line. And the line bundle will have degree one on one component, which is going to be an isomorphism, and it will have degree two on the other component. But then you see this, you have this line and there are four points on it. So it's just a fixed cross ratio of points. And that's exactly the cross ratio that you see in the scattering amplitude. So somehow there is this one cross ratio for one component, another cross ratio for another component. And all you're doing, you know, you're mapping two P1s into one P1. And I just wanted to say, you know, that in fact, that's exactly what we studied with Anna Maria before, and it was sort of the impetus for my work, is that we studied what I now understand are this sort of a maximally degenerate MHV curves, which are just union of lines, you know, with three points on each line, right? And we gave this condition, which surprisingly wasn't known to physicists, you know, that in fact, you know, this curve is an MHV curve, and that's exactly what physicists care about, if and only if there is this hypertree condition, that these triples of points in HP1 are not random triples, you know, but there is this condition that, for example, five triples have to cover at least seven points, three triples have to cover at least five points, this kind of convexity condition, you know, which we introduce. And this exactly characterizes this maximally degenerate stable M curves, you know, that we studied. And maybe I'll just stop here, yeah, because this was the original motivation, and only now I realize, you know, that what we were secretly doing, you know, we were trying to understand this problem from physics, you know, trying to understand scattering amplitude of curves. And just like physicists did, we started with this most degenerate situation. So actually physicists study something called the on-shell diagram, you know, which kind of like looks like this,
you know, but you know, what I realize is that it's even nicer if you take a smooth curve instead and study the scattering amplitude. And it's a beautiful picture. You know, you can take a smooth curve, take its scattering amplitude, past the limit, you know, you get the stable curve, take its scattering amplitude, and probability distributions converge.
Good. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
It's hard to clap here. You can clap using the chat. So do we have any question for Genia? In fact, this is not a real question. You say this is a convexity axiom. It is really a question of...
Well, I mean, no, the word convexity, I think it's a bad word here. I don't think it's really... I mean, I just had to come up with some word, and we did come up with this word. But what I want to say, though, is that why did we call this condition hyper-tree condition? Well, because, you see, if instead of triples, you take pairs, right? If you take pairs of points, then... You know, then this and instead of two, take one, right? So then what this would say is that if you have a graph and you know you have n edges, any n edges, you know, then they have to cover at least n plus one points. And that's exactly if you think about it, what it's an equivalent definition of a tree. Yeah, and so if you just do it with triples instead of pairs and put two here instead of one, you know, then that's what
this I asked is. Because convexity implies some positivity. You're not implying any positivity.
Yeah, well, yeah. As I said, the word convexity here, you know, was just sort of chosen mostly for fun. But I mean, but what this does imply, right, is that a certain map, the scattering amplitude map that we study. Right, so the map from the all line bundles to M0n is a dominant map, right? So it's kind of like the union of, you know, so you try to cover as much as possible combinatorially by your triples, but on the geometric side, you cover as much as possible geometrically, right? So you can get any n points in M0n from a line bundle and vice versa. So you have this.
So there is a more interesting questions.
Sure.
Can you elaborate a bit more which scattering amplitudes are you getting, which specific theories?
Oh, no, this is a very difficult, difficult question, right? So basically, let me go back a little bit. As I said, I don't know how far I can go back. By some reason, I can't. Oh, no, I can. So let's go back to this, to the setup. So this is the physical setup, right? So this is basically, you know, what physicists call the, you know, four-dimensional Young Mills, like a massless Young Mills, right? So you have n massless particles in four dimensions in the Minkowski space, but the thing is that you need to use, I mean, it's only the MHV, this maximum helicity violating regime, you know, that you know I have studied so far in the smooth case. So maybe I have to emphasize that I'm not really doing physics here. I'm doing kind of like a physically inspired mathematics. What physicists study, I mean, they study this maximally degenerate case, you know, and so if you have this sort of a maximally degenerate case, you know, kind of like this on shell diagram here, you know, then it sort of describes interaction between particles, right? So this is a good example, of this on shell diagram and places this kind of a nodes. So dots here correspond to this, to Riemann spheres, right? So which we are connecting. And then this is a channel, right? So this channel is when you have kind of two virtual particles crossing, right? And you have this, you have your N actual particles. This was called the on shell diagram in physics. It's not a Feynman diagram. It describes the actual kind of interaction. And then you have this kind of maybe kind of virtual particles, which are kind of exchanged through the node, right? So I guess the short answer is that it's sort of related to four-dimensional supersymmetric Young Mills, you know, but, you know, I don't know, physicists don't really look at smooth Riemann surfaces. I mean, like all the literature that at least I'm aware of, it deals, you know, with this kind of pictures that really describe some sort of interactions between particles. Yeah, but what I realized is that if you take a smooth course, then you just get a much like a really beautiful answer. And my belief is that if you have a beautiful answer in mathematics, I mean, sooner or later it will show up in physics.
Okay, do we have any other question? I don't see any other question. Okay, so we thank you again. We are very happy that you gave it to here.
Well, and I hope to visit you again. I hope to prove more stuff.
You can't do science.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
People say that is a nice talk. Maybe you probably can read the chat, right?
Well, I wasn't reading it, so because I don't know how to do it.
The bottom of the menu, there is.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Chao a todos. Gracias. Chao, Inés. Muchas gracias. Chao.